On behalf of myself and everybody here, I would like to welcome you all in this international webinar. Tonight is an exceptional night, just to acknowledge the huge effort of Prof Ansary for the Mega Online course and the unprecedented number of lectures and the huge, what we call it, the Encyclopedia for Intensive Care Medicine. I would like to thank all my senior colleagues coming here tonight as a moderator and the speakers to participate in this unprecedented talk. First of all, Prof Ansary is very well known, and I would like to give him the mic. Thank you.
Good evening, my colleague. Good evening, our attendees. Really, when someone done something that has affected us in a positive way, of course you affected me and add to me too much pleasure and happiness in the last days. It is important, so, and even mandatory, to appreciate them, to appreciate you, and thank you. Thanks for Dr. Saad. Thanks for all our colleagues. Thanks for our attendees. Dr. Saad, you and your team really give me a bold chance to share, to know, to communicate with many, many famous and professional guest speakers. Of course, they add to me more experience, both in academic and in the clinical work. And so today I wanted to say something. Thanks for all of you. Thanks for you from my heart. Thank you. Michael, you.
Thank you, Prof. Really very emotional. And what you have done is really unprecedented. And you collected all of those people around you, and you made the Mega Online course viable and sustainable and supported in the same time. Whatever word I say is not enough to say thank you very much for your effort. Prof. Nabil Askalani, Dr. Khalda, you take the lead now and introduce other viewers. Thank you.
Many thanks, Dr. Saad. Many thanks, Dr. Samir, for your kind words. It's really a great honor to share in such a great day in Mega Anesthesiology course in honor of Dr. Samir. He is an eminent professor in intensive care at Shams University, and he always enriches the course with his valuable and useful lectures. Spends a lot of his time and effort for the sake of science and people. Many thanks, Dr. Samir. We will introduce, inshallah, Dr. Nabil Al-Asqalani, General Doctor, President of the Egyptian Anesthesia Society. We will go on, Dr. Nabil. You can start for a free talk. ازيك يا باشا زي حضرتك
الله يخليك الحمد لله
great honor to have you with us ان شاء الله تفضل حضرتك
my honor بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم as a matter of fact it's my honor delight and privilege to be amongst such very eminent speakers and eminent colleagues as a matter of fact this course has been held in collaboration with the Egyptian Society of Anesthesiologists and it's honor to our society before being honor to you. In the meantime, we have got a main target. All of us have got the same target, which is safety of the patient and the welfare of the anesthetist. So this course, as a matter of fact, had very eminent speakers. First of all, I'd like to express my sincere gratitude to Professor Saad al-Mahdi for his great efforts which were behind the success of this course together with his colleagues. In the meantime, I would like to congratulate him for being head of the anesthesia department. In the meantime, for being elected as an examiner in the European diploma. This is an honor to us before being honored to him. I won't ever forget to cordially thank Professor Hassan Manna', Professor Makharita for their dedicated services, and the rest of the colleagues too. Finally, as regards Professor Samir Elansary, as a matter of fact, no words can convey my extreme thankfulness and gratefulness to him because he was the active dynamo of this course. He offered a lot of his time in spite of his obligations. His presentations were very fruitful and beneficial, so no words can convey my thanks to him. His enthusiasm and perseverance were behind the success of this course. And finally, I'd like to thank all colleagues and all participants, all speakers of this course for their dedicated services and their outstanding performance. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Nabil. And Dr. Khalda, take the lead, please. Dr. Ansari, do you want to?
Thanks, Dr. Nabil, for your nice words. Thank you for all.
It's
a great honor for us, really, to sharing this webinar. Really.
Thank you very much.
Many thanks, dear doctors. We will start our lectures. We'll start with our very dear friend, Dr. Ahmed Zaghloul. He is an associate professor of physiology, Cairo University. He will talk about postoperative pain relief. Dr. Ahmed, please share your screen. Dr. Ahmed Zaghloul.
I'm sharing now. Thank you so much, Dr. Khalda, for your kind and nice words. And special thanks to Professor Dr. Samir for his efforts. So I'm going to talk about how to improve post-operative pain relief. As we know that the effective relief of pain is of the utmost importance to anyone treating patients undergoing surgery. And monitoring of pain relief is increasingly becoming an important post-operative quality measure. However, more than 80% of patients who undergo surgical procedures experience acute post-operative pain, and nearly 75% of those patients report severe to moderate to severe pain post-operative. And unfortunately, improperly controlled post-operative pain have many bad sequelae and complications. Improperly treated pain may negatively affect the quality of life function, the functional recovery, and the risk of post-operative complications also may increase the risk of development of chronic post-surgical pain, which may persist for more than 3 months. Despite we know what causes the post-operative pain, and we know the mechanism, we know how to treat it, and we know the best drugs for it, we know also that most of the post-operative pain is self-limited. So the question now, what is the reason of feeling behind after surgery? The International Association for the Study of Pain tried to answer this question and to investigate for the obstacles that led to or hinder against the proper management of acute post-operative pain. And they stated that the surgeon and the healthcare providers who see the patients in the acute post-operative phase may have the misconception that acute pain vanishes in a few days. And as long as the operation was successful, the post-operative pain will soon be forgotten. So why to implement a costly acute post-operative pain service and to use techniques as epidural or peripheral nerve plugs, which may not be free from complications? Also, they do not expect that acute pain may develop into chronic pain. So they use the traditional way for post-operative pain management. They use unimodal analgesia, usually narcotics, and they give the patient the analgesia only when the patient asks for it. Not they do not have a plan before starting surgery and the plan for post-operative analgesia after they finish their surgery. So in around 2016, the American Pain Society, in collaboration with the American Society of Regional Anesthesia and Pain Medicine and the American Society of Anesthesiologists, published their guidelines on the management of post-operative pain. And they recommended around 32 recommendations. In my opinion, the most important of which is the recommendation number 6, which stated that clinicians should offer the multimodal analgesia or the use of a variety of analgesic medications and techniques combined with non-pharmacological interventions for treatment of post-operative pain in children and adults. So what is meant by multimodal analgesia? The modal analgesia is the use of a variety of analgesic medications and techniques combined with non-pharmacological interventions. And the main goal of it is to reduce the amount and consumption of post-operative opioids. So for example, if we prescribe non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications plus paracetamol and doing nerve block, this will decrease the amount of the post-operative opioids that can we use. And hence we can get the benefits of multimodal analgesia by reducing the doses of each analgesic and reducing the side effects of each drug. And this at the end will improve the pain relief due to synergistic or additive effect, as each modality will act by different mechanisms. This is the WHO step ladder. Step 1 is mild pain, 2 is the moderate pain, and 3 is the severe pain. Mild pain, we can use non-opioids as paracetamol and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications. In moderate pain, we can add weak opioid as tramadol, and in severe pain, we can use strong opioid plus the other non-opioid medications. And with all this, we can use the non-pharmacological therapy. These are the assessment tools that can we use to assess the severity of pain post-operative. And this is the pain pathway. If we imagine that there is injury at the periphery, so there will be sensitization of the peripheral nociceptors, and with the release of inflammatory mediators and the neurotransmitters as substance B, then the signal will be transmitted by the peripheral nerve to the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, and then to the thalamus through the spinothalamic tract, and then to the central gyrus. So what happens after surgery? Surgical injury will be associated with peripheral sensitization of the nociceptors and central insensitization at the level of the dorsal horn with the release of the neurotransmitter glutamate. So peripheral sensitization, if not well treated, will lead to primary hyperalgesia, and secondary sensitization will lead to secondary hyperalgesia, and if not treated well, will lead to long-term pain and chronic pain that may persist for more than 3 months. So after surgery, we have primary hyperalgesia and secondary hyperalgesia. Primary hyperalgesia mainly treated with anti-inflammatory medications as non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, either selective or non-selective, dexamethasone and infiltration with local anesthetic. Secondary hyperalgesia can be treated with medications that act centrally as the opioids, ketamine, gabapentinoids, alpha-2 agonist, and neuroaxial blocks. As I said, secondary hyperalgesia, if not treated well and if ignored, may lead to chronic post-surgical pain. Again, this is a pathway of pain, and these are the pharmacological and non-pharmacological interventions that act at different sites of the pathway. For example, peripherally, the local anesthetic can act peripherally, and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications. Also, local anesthetic act as the peripheral nerve, together with anticonvulsants and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications. This is a table which shows the interventions, either pharmacological or non-pharmacological. I have a comment here that there are several observational studies that correlate between the use of high doses of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications and the non-union in spinal fusion and surgery for surgeries and the anastomotic leak in intestinal surgery. However, the panel found that there was no sufficient evidence to recommend against the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications. Also, regional techniques and the blocks as a part of multimodal analgesia. This is a meta-analysis to try to investigate how regional anesthesia prevent chronic pain after surgery. And they concluded that epidural anesthesia may reduce the risk of developing chronic pain by about 25%, and paravertebral block may reduce the risk of chronic pain by about 20%. This is the PCA. And if we imagine that the patient, this is the circle, the patient who feel pain, he calls the nurse and the nurse start assessment and then prepare, call the surgeon and prepare the medication and then give the patient the medication. We can bypass all this by using the PCA. As the patient feels pain, he can give himself a shot and immediately this will relieve his pain. So the advantages of the PCA, patient can titrate their analgesia to their pain, a rapid response to the demand for analgesia, and the reduced patient anxiety compared with other analgesic techniques. This is a list of the strong recommendations. We can provide the adults and children with acetaminophen and or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications in patients without contraindications to these medications. We can consider the use of perioperative, preoperative dose of oral COX-2 inhibitor in adult patients. Consider the use of oral gabapentin or pregabalin. Consider surgical site-specific peripheral regional anesthetic techniques and offer neuroaxial analgesia with opioids and or local anesthetics for major thoracic and abdominal procedures, particularly in patients at risk for prolonged ileus or cardiac and pulmonary complications. Avoid the use of IM route for administration of analgesics, and use IV PCA when the parenteral route is needed. However, don't use routine basal infusion of opioids in opioid naive adults, and avoid neuroaxial administration of magnesium, benzodiazepines, neostigmine, tramadol, and ketamine. This is another table that shows different surgeries and how can we apply the multimodal analgesia. If we take the open laparotomy as an example, so we can give systemic pharmacologic therapy, including opioids, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, and or acetaminophen plus gabapentin. And we intraoperatively, we can do local anesthetic infiltration at the incision, and we can do regional anesthetic technique as tap lock. Moreover, we can insert an epidural catheter and use non-pharmacological therapies as TENS and cryotherapy or heat therapy. To summarize, multimodal analgesia is the approach of choice for relieving post-surgical pain. Using analgesics in at least two medication classes and non-pharmacological therapies, clinicians are able to target different pain mechanisms along multiple sites of nociceptive pathway. Thank you.
Many thanks, Dr. Ahmed, for this brief, concise lecture.